Okay. So let's just quickly recap in 2 minutes what we did this morning. So we said that Feynman integrals are always periods, and an interesting class of periods that is well understood are multiple polylogarithms. And I recall here the definition. They are defined as iterated integrals over kernels with logarithmic singularities. And then we started to investigate the properties of these functions. So we said here n is the weight, the number of integrations. We said that these functions form a Schaffel algebra. And that, at least conjecturally, there are no relations among functions of different weight. For the experts, this means that the algebra is graded. Well, actually, well, we come there. Okay, and so we also said that there are lots of identities among these functions. And what we're going to see now is kind of a more systematic approach of how to find these identities or how to deal with them. And the mathematical background for this is called a Hopf algebra. So what is a Hopf algebra? So I guess we all know, first of all, what an algebra is. An algebra is a vector space. Well, if you're more mathematically inclined, you could even take a module, but let's stick with the vector space with multiplication. I guess this everybody knows. Multiplication that turns it into a ring. So there's a unit, and it's associative. Okay, and you have the distribution law. So I'm going to now define for you an alternative way of saying the same thing, which looks very complicated, but which will be useful later on. So I can state the exact same statements in the following way. So my algebra, my vector space, call it A. Okay. I'm going to give you a linear map that goes from the tensor product of A to itself. It's linear. Such that now it gets folkloristic. We'll explain this in a second. It is the identity. This is nothing but associativity. What it means is, I take 3 elements. If you're not too familiar with the mathematics behind tensor products, think of it as like pairs or triplets. I take 3. I act with it on the first, so I don't change it. And I multiply the last two. So I started with ABC. And now I multiply the last two. And then I multiply them together. So I land in A. So I get now ABC. Yeah, this. And this must be the same as first multiplying together the first two and not doing nothing to the last one. And then I multiply together both of them. And then, of course, I add a land on A, B, C, and that must be the same thing. So it's associative. Right now, this just looks like a complicated way of writing things, but it will be helpful later on. Well, in a second, actually. Now, we had this statement that there are no relations among different weights. So let me also put the weight into the picture. Actually, what I'm going to say is that A, for me, is a direct sum of other vector spaces, where An, for me, will be the vector space of weight N. Okay. Then the statement that the shuffle algebra preserves the weight means that if I take something of weight N and I multiply it by something of weight M, I get something of weight M plus N. So in other words, if I, in terms of spaces, if I take this space and that space, it lands in the space of where the weight is the sum. This is what is called a graded algebra. So a graded algebra is an algebra that has a direct sum decomposition that satisfies this.
Sorry.
Yeah?
Could you explain again what that dot is between?
Multiplication. This is, so it's, I have two vectors, well, two algebras. Or two vector spaces, I consider the space spanned by all possible products of the two.
By the subset, you're saying that. Sorry.
Is this not the east? This is graded computation. So
this is graded because I require the sum to be direct.
I suppose that you this has spaces of given weight.
Yes, so for polylogs.
If you multiply two guys of weights M and N, is it the product precisely of weight M plus N?
Yes. Because remember that what it does is it's like shuffling cards. It's like if GAZ times GBZ, that was GABZ plus GBAZ. So if I have weight 1 and weight 1, I get weight 2, weight 2. So it's a product is exactly of weight 2. It's connected to this, that there are no relations among functions of different weights. So I always stay inside the same direct summand. I can never go across different weights. At the level of the shuffle algebra, this is a proven fact. In general, if you have more complicated relations, it's conjectural. Yes?
By the subset, are you saying that there are some multiple polylogarithms that can't be created as products of?
Yeah, because otherwise everything would fall apart into logs, right?
And is that true for every type of weight? Or?
Yes.
Yeah.
So, okay, this would go too far for this lecture, but you can actually, if you have a shuffle algebra, you can write down an explicit basis, and at every weight, there are kind of indecomposable elements. Yes, but remember that you need the last argument to be the same. But if you have an expression where the last argument is the same, then the basis is given by this basis. It comes from the shuffle algebra, which is called the Lindenwert basis. Okay. So far it was just complicated rewriting of stuff that we know. So now we're going to introduce something else. It's called a coalgebra. And there, this picture here will be handy. I'm not going to give all the axioms of what a coalgebra is, just going to give the ones that we need. So a coalgebra will be the algebraic structure that you get when you reverse all these arrows. So I take now a vector space, call it C for coalgebra, and I have a linear map delta. So the multiplication goes from take 2, make 1. The co-multiplication delta, you take 1 and you return 2. And in particular, it's required to be co-associative. What that means is you reverse all the arrows in this picture. So it means that if you start from one element and you break it into 2, and then if I have 2 elements, I can now iterate the breaking. I could either break the first one or the second one, but I must get the same answer. I'm not going to draw the picture. You could draw the same picture, you just reverse all the arrows. This formula becomes this requirement. This looks complicated. It just means that you have an operation on your vector space that allows you to break things into 2. And if I iterate this, I break it into 3, into 4, there's a unique way of doing this. So this means that it is a unique iteration. We'll see examples in a second. Now, I also want this, if my vector space is graded, I want this breaking to be consistent with this. So a coalgebra is graded, if C is a direct sum of spaces, such that if I act with the co-multiplication of my space, what I actually get is that I always land, if I act with the co-multiplication on the weight n, I just break it into 2 things, such that the sum of the 2 weights is, again, the original weight. If I start from a weight 2 object and I break it into 2, I can break it into weight 2 tensor weight 0, weight 1 tensor weight 1, or weight 0 tensor weight 1. Weight 2, and so on. So what is a Hopf algebra? So this is abstract now, but it will become concrete when you go to polylogs. A Hopf algebra, roughly speaking, is at the same time an algebra, a coalgebra, and here I have multiplication mu, co-multiplication delta, such that these 2 operations are compatible. Meaning, if I take the co-product of a product, it is the same as delta of the product. It's multiplicative. One technical aside here, for those who are not too familiar with tensor products, the multiplication of tensors is component-wise. Because you see here, each delta lives in, gives me a tensor. So this is actually multiplication of tensors. And the multiplication of tensors is always component-wise. Now, for the experts, there's some more stuff here, but we're not going to introduce it because we don't need it. Okay. Good. So that is just some abstract algebra. Now, the amazing thing is that you can actually prove, this was done by Sasha Goncharov, multiple polylogs form a Hopf algebra. Now, for that, I still need to tell you what this delta is. But that by itself is already rather amazing. You can define on these functions a Hopf algebra structure. So they come, just this naive definition is these iterated integrals of dt over t minus a hides inside some much, much deeper algebraic structure. Okay.
What you are saying means that linear functionals form an algebra.
Linear functions form an algebra.
Co-algebra is basically something.
Oh, okay. I see what you mean. Yes, you want to you ask what is the dual of this space?
Yeah.
Now, okay. Since this is a Hopf algebra. It turns, okay, this would now go much, much further. This is actually, this Hopf algebra is the dual of some algebraic group.
Yeah.
Which you can define explicitly, yes.
Yeah.
Now, we're not going there. That leads to what's the Galois theory of these objects. But we don't need that. But indeed, you can define these things themselves are, well, you can interpret the polylogs as essentially linear functions on an algebraic group.
What?
Oh, and there's some algebraic group whose dual is precisely isomorphic to this. Because the dual of an algebraic group is a Hopf algebra. Okay, so I will not give you the rule of how to compute a co-product in for a general multiple poly log. It can be done. It's purely combinatorial. You can put it on a computer. But to explain it would take too long for this lecture. It would take a whole hour just to explain how to compute it, how to give the general rule. So rather, I will just give you examples. If you want the full construction, there are lecture of Tarsi 2014, there you find many examples.
So is this Hopf algebra
co-commutative? No, it's commutative. This is commutative. This is a commutative Hopf algebra because the multiplication will simply be the multiplication of functions, so we're just commutative. This one is commutative. So, so let's look at examples. Maybe let's go to another board because otherwise people in the back can't see. This is important. So I need to define delta. And I will give you delta explicitly for the logarithm and for the Li2, Li3 functions. And if you want the more general ones, then you can look, sorry, at the Tarsi lectures. So I need to tell you what is delta. For example, delta of a log. It should be something that gives me two, gives me back two objects, right? But it must also preserve the grading. So I have a weight one object. So this is weight one. Well, the only thing I can do with weight one is either weight 0 or weight 1, or weight 1 and weight 0. That's the only pair of ways I can split it. So the only natural thing that this could be is this. Okay? Which makes intuitively sense, because the logarithm is like the building block from which everything arises. So that is the thing that cannot be broken apart any further. In no non-trivial way. That's what this formula means. For the experts, this is what is called a primitive element in your Hopf-algebra. So what about higher weight functions? For example, Li N, we had this morning. Now, the formula looks like this. So this has weight n. And now I should give you all possible decompositions. One decomposition is weight 0, weight n, so 1, and then the function itself. That's one way to break the function apart, not to break it apart at all. There's another trivial way of breaking the function apart. It's this one. But now I have all possible ways of having like weight 1 with n minus 1, 2, n minus 2, and so on. And what I have to write here is this. Let me discuss it a bit. Oh, yes, sorry, n0. And this is n minus k, k. OK, this looks pretty ad hoc at this point. But remember that you must satisfy many constraints. For example, it must be such that if I iterate the construction, I still get the same answer. Or, for example, if I take a product of two dialogues, this identity must hold. Okay? So, it's not random, and we'll see a bit later that there's some deeper meaning to it. But the fact that such a formula exists that satisfies all of this is remarkable. Okay. You mean flipping them? Yeah, okay, but that's like a trivial automorphism of the thing, right? No, and but let's wait 5 minutes and then you will see it, because there's a meaning to both the left and the right. They have specific meanings, and then you see that it's actually at least extremely hard to cook up anything else. And I would guess it's impossible. Except for like the trivial modifications, like swapping left and right.
Is this a particular case of Kramer constructions?
No. So Kramer's, for example, is co-commutative. This is commutative. So I'm not aware of any map that goes from this to Kramer's algebra of trees. Because that one is co-commutative, as far as I remember, at least. Well, no, it's commutative, sorry, yeah. But at least I'm not aware of any map from here to the other one.
So if we're multiplying Li n minus k with Li of...
Sorry?
If we had an Li instead of a log of k,
yeah.
it would not be...
It wouldn't work. And you will see in a second that there's more that comes out of this. And then you will see why you could not put Li k here. Good. So, yeah?
Why don't you have the opposite?
You don't. You will, wait for the, huh? Sorry, you could add it, yes.
Okay.
But it wouldn't work.
Okay.
You will see why in 2 minutes. The formulas are a bit magical. The fact that things work the way they do. Because there's actually more to this. I need more. If I want to compute, I need more. Because what are the two basic operations that I can do with polylogs? And this answers your question and yours. So let's do that first. So what are the two basic operations that we had this morning that I can do? Yes, I can take discontinuities. Okay. Another operation that I can do, but we didn't mention it explicitly, it was more implicit. These things are defined as integrals, so I can differentiate them. Okay, that's not a very natural thing that I can do. Now, what I claim is that all that is encoded in here. Namely, let's look at an example. Let's look at derivatives first. You can easily take the integral definition of Li2 to show that this holds. This just follows from the integral definition. So now, let's act with delta on this. That is delta of minus 1 over z log 1 minus z. Now, I can use this formula. So this is delta of minus 1 over z, delta of log 1 minus z. Okay. Now, this is delta of something which has weight 0. It's a rational function. Now, delta will act trivially on everything that has weight 0, because it should not decompose it at all. Right? Because it must. It's graded, so it cannot decompose anything that has weight 0. So this thing will give me minus 1 over z for the first one. And this one follows from the formula up there. OK?
Sorry, why must it be activated on things with weight
0?
Why must it activate on things with weight 0?
Because. OK, I can give a quick answer, because that's the way it is defined. But if you want, the interpretation is that what the delta does is it takes something of weight n and gives you the decomposition in all possible lower weights. If it has weight 0, the only thing it could do is like not doing anything at all. It's like when we had the log of weight 1, there was just the two trivial ways of decomposing it. If I start from weight 0, I cannot decompose it into any lower weights, because there's nothing. Formally, at the mathematical level, it would be defined like this, because I didn't actually tell you what are the scalars in my of my vector space, and those would be the rational functions.
OK.
No, rational numbers, if you want.
Question?
Yeah?
Is there a reason we're not just switching the notation on the log and you calling it log Li1? Because it just seems that
you could
have logs of 1 minus z's all over the place.
You can do that if you want, but okay. You can actually check that this formula would also hold then. You would have Li1, 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 and here the sum would be empty, so you recover this formula here. Good. So now let's do something different. So we had now the derivative. Fine, that's what it is. And now let's look at this. I can use the formula up there. And then I have the sum term that comes from the sum. And here, well, if you want, you can write Li1 But Li1 is actually, it's minus log 1 minus z. This just follows from the definition of these functions.
What about the identity that Li2 of 1 minus z is given?
We'll do it in a second. Okay. So, and now let's compare this to this. What you see is the following. So, let me differentiate only in the second slot. What do I get? If I differentiate in the second slot, then this gives me 0. Derivative of 1 is 0. You all agree with that. If I differentiate this in the second slot, I get 1 over z. If I differentiate this in the second slot, I get minus log 1 minus z over z. It's the formula here. Okay? So if I differentiate in the second slot, what I get is 1 tensor minus log 1 minus z over z plus 0 plus or minus log 1 minus z tensor 1 over z. And this, so this z, 1 over z is a rational number. Rational numbers are scalars. They can go wherever they want, the second or the first or the second slot. So I can write this like this. So minus 1 over z is a scalar, I pull it out. Minus 1 over z, I pull it out. And then you find the same thing as what I had here. So differentiating and then acting with the co-product is the same as computing the co-product and then just differentiating the second slot. So you can write this as follows. The co-product of a derivative is the same as only acting with the derivative in the second slot and with identity in the first. We had another operation on polylogs, a very natural one, which was discontinuities. And I guess you can now guess what's going to happen. Namely, well, let's do the same operation. Let's do the same game for discontinuities. So we said this morning that discontinuity around z equals 1 of Li2 of z is 2 pi I log z. Ah, no, before, okay. Before we do that, we need something else. Otherwise, we will go crazy. Because there's actually a problem still, which actually shows up here as well for the first time. So the issue is the following. Issue. So we said this morning that Li2 of 1 is pi squared over 6. Okay? So this is also called zeta 2. I use zeta 2 now because otherwise I get coefficients wrong because in my notes it's always zetas, not with pi's. So Li4 of 1 is a number called zeta 4, which is pi squared over 90, pi to the 4 over 90. And this is 2 divided by 5 zeta 2 squared. Okay. And now let me act with my delta. So my delta of zeta 4 That is 2 divided by 5. I can pull out the rational number, zeta 2 squared. Okay? But what is delta of zeta 2? Delta of zeta 2 is delta of li 2 of 1. Now, if you look at this formula, if I put z equal to 1, all this garbage disappears. I just need to take these two terms. So this would be zeta 2 tensor 1. Well, let's use the same notation. Yeah. Tensor 1 plus 1 tensor zeta 2. These are just the first two terms, because the log z contribution goes away. And so if you plug that in and you expand it out, you get the following. You get 2 divided by 5, 1 tensor zeta 2 squared, plus 2 times zeta 2 tensor zeta 2, plus zeta 2 squared tensor 1. Or I can also write it as 1 tensor zeta 4, plus 4 divided by 5 zeta 2 tensor zeta 2, plus zeta 4 tensor 1. That is what it is. But I have a problem. Because I could also have said that this is delta of li 4 of 1. Because zeta 4 is li 4 of 1. And use this formula here. Then, again, all this stuff goes away. I just need these two terms. This gives me 1 tensor li 4 of 1, which is zeta 4, plus li 4 of 1, zeta 4, tensor 1. And I'm missing this term, which is the one that I got from the double product when I took the square. Okay, so there's an inconsistency. Now, if you look at the original work by Goncharov, I was actually lying. This was not the statement. The statement is that this is a Hopf algebra if you consider pi to be 0. On more algebraic terms, you work modulo something. Putting pi to 0 means effectively modulo branch cuts, because every discontinuity is proportional to a pi. So what forms a Hopf algebra is your polylog modulo their branch cuts, essentially. Okay, so that was one solution one. Pi is equal to 0. This is a bit written in a provocative way. It means modulo something. Solution two, that goes back to Francis Brown in 2010 or something like that, is that you need a special rule that you say this behaves like this. You drop the second term. What that means is you still work modulo branch cuts, but only in the second slot, not in the first. Then, of course, you can easily check that all these issues go away, because wherever I have a pi in the second slot, I put pi to 0. So this means this is the same as saying pi is equal to 0 in second slot. And then, of course, all my issues go away, trivially. It's, of course, mathematically, it's much deeper than this. It's like the practitioner's thing if you want to do computations. You will see in the second example where this really is crucial. Okay? So actually, I need to supplement this list by another rule, which is that whenever I have a pi in the second slot, I can throw it away.
Pi played a very special role.
Yeah, it's connected to this. It's because, I mean, in the deep meaning is that you have two classes of periods, semi-simple ones and unipotent ones. there's like a classification that you can make. And for polylogs, one part of the classification is pi and the other part is everything else. If you go beyond genus zero, there's more stuff that is special.
So this assumed from the beginning that you never divided by pi.
Yeah, and I also said that 1/π is not a period, so it's not part of the construction in the first place. Now, if you want to extend it, it would be actually delta of 1/π would be 1/π tensor 1. It's like a group-like object in the end. That's the only natural thing you can do if you want to preserve the fact that delta is multiplicative. Okay? Yeah? Then it again it wouldn't work for a reason that you will see now. That would then you would also swap this.
If you swap
left and right everywhere, you get the same thing. Just you read from left to right instead of from right to left. If you swap it there but not here, it becomes inconsistent. You will see, let's work the example of the discontinuities. And then you will see that it becomes inconsistent.
Well,
yeah.
Does the second so the first solution, if we considered other special integer evaluations of polylogs, like say Li4 of 2 or something like that, does that get cured in the same way? Here?
Yeah, this cures everything. Again, there are much deeper mathematical reasons for this. And then this is like the only special case that shows up. That's why it cures everything for the practitioner if you use this rule. So let's look at an example where this is crucial. Let's go through the same exercise that we did here for derivatives, but now for discontinuities. So we said this morning that the discontinuity around z equals 1 of V2 of z is 2 pi I log z. And there you see that the pi shows up, so things may go wrong. So let's now take the correction of this, delta of that. That is now delta of 2 pi I times delta of log z. Because it's multiplicative, is 2 pi I tensor 1, because pi is special. And the 2 I could pull out, because it's a constant. Well, it's an algebraic constant. And the log looks like this. If I put it back together, I get now 2 pi I. That's this term, times log z. Multiplication is component-wise, so 2 pi I times 1, 1 times log, plus 2 pi I times log. Tensor 1 times 1. And now, let's compare it again to delta of V2. Now let's see what happens if I take the discontinuity only in the first slot. This is 2 pi I log z tensor 1, which is this term. This one, the first slot, has no discontinuity, so that one goes away. And here, the first slot is a log, which has a, well, plus or minus 2 pi I. If you do it consistently with the branch, the way you chose the branch code for V2, then here the discontinuity is minus 2 pi I. And so this whole thing combined is 2 pi I tensor log z, which is this term. Sorry? Because it only takes discontinuity in the first entry. And here the first entry is 1, which is constant. Yeah. Like, just like here, I only did it in the second, but discontinuity I only did it in the first. And you see, if I had, this answers the question, could I do it only, swap this rule? If I had swapped it here, I would get the wrong answer. So it's a very delicate conspiracy of many things. So the conclusion is that the coproduct of a discontinuity is the same as taking discontinuity only in the first entry. For the experts to foreshadow what's coming next, this is actually the first entry condition. This is like the deep root of the first entry condition, for those who know what it is. And this is the deep root of why Feynman integral satisfy differential equations.
Is that correct, that this condition really completely determines the whole product?
Yeah, so that's what I want to say next, to come back to Eric's question. How much freedom do you have? Well, if you insist on this, I don't think that there's any freedom left, up to trivial changes. Because this basically tells you that, like, that it's determined by differential equation, and you fix the way the monotomy acts. And so up to trivial changes, I don't think there's anything you can do to it. OK, so in the, how much time do I have left? 10 minutes?
Yeah, about 10 minutes.
Yeah. Good. Are there questions?
I do not see that on Blackboard. Do I understand correctly that your definition of co-product is not symmetric with respect to first and second?
No, because then it would be co-commutative. This is, if it was symmetric, it would be co-commutative.
Yeah.
But this is not. It's a commutative, but not co-commutative.
It seems that you can interchange this first and second guy in the product, and still it will remain.
No, I cannot. It's not symmetric. I cannot swap things from left to right. It's not co-commutative.
Yes.
If it was symmetric, if I could flip it like this, it would be co-commutative as a Hopf algebra. It's deeply asymmetric, precisely because the left knows about discontinuities and the right knows about derivatives.
The form of it is not symmetric.
No.
Yeah.
Delta itself is not symmetric. OK, so maybe let's come back to your comments. So what about this identity? So what can I do with this? So I have now a set of rules. So what can I do? So let's go and I'll discuss two examples. Yeah, it should be just enough time for this. One is very easy, a bit trivial, but just warm up. And then the second one, you'll actually see everything in action. Again, you will see why this is important. So the examples will be how to find identities among functions. And again, this is a comment that I made already this morning. Here, of course, you have a notion of, human input, right? If you rewrite things in a more beautiful way, it's always what you think is more beautiful. Okay? Just because the number of terms shrinks does not mean it's more beautiful. But let's say you start with an expression, let's call it T. It's lead 2 of 1 minus z plus log z log 1 minus z. And if you remember this morning, we had a formula that contained lead 2 of 1 minus z and expressed in terms of other things. So I could rewrite these things another way, but let's assume I don't know that formula. So let's act with delta. Now, delta always contains this two trivial bits, right? Two ways of decomposing something is not decomposed at all. And then what is left is often called now delta 1, 1. So that is the part of the co-product where you have weight 1 in the first slot, weight 1 in the second slot. Because I started, I have weight 2, so I can organize it all in the, well, I erased the formula, but it was graded, so it was a direct sum of things. Okay? So let's compute delta 1, 1 of t. You can use the formulas that I gave you, and what you would see is this. This is, the lead 2 gives me this bit. And then this, since it is a product, will be symmetric. See, it's like this. So the square brackets are just to indicate which terms come from where. And you see that, well, this product is symmetric in the 2, so it must better be a symmetric tensor. Now you can, of course, easily see that this cancels this. And so this is actually just log 1 minus z tensor log z. But if you compare it to this bit, which came from here, this is actually just delta 1, 1 of minus lead 2 of z. And so, what do I conclude? Well, I conclude that t is equal to minus lead 2 of z. Sorry? Well, you're missing a piece now, yes. You could add anything plus c such that delta 1, 1 of c is equal to 0. And which are they? These are precisely the objects that are called primitive. These are the ones that I cannot decompose.
Should that be c, not 1?
Yes, sorry. These are the primitive elements. Now, in practice, so you should think of this thing as like an integration constant. That's actually what it is. Well, almost. In practice, these things that you're missing, that is an empirical statement. So, empirically, C is always a zeta value for something like zeta 2, zeta 3, or something like that, roughly. There's a few more things it could be, but essentially, for all practical purposes, what you're missing is zeta values.
Pure
zeta? Sorry?
Oh, I guess never mind.
Some zeta, yeah. Of course, some zeta values do detect. Some of them are decomposable. But roughly speaking, it's the depth one, the one that is not decomposable. More generally, for the experts, it's like all possible polylogs aren't at roots of unity. Those you could also miss, but they're already much more special.
Sorry, can you say again what the notation delta 1, 1 means?
So delta, so my delta acts here on a weight 2 object. So a weight 2 object is decomposed into always that 2 trivial bits. They're always there.
Yeah.
And then I have the one in the middle. Okay? This one is here. This one is here. And whatever is left, I call it delta 1, 1. It's the bit that has weight 1 in the first slot and weight 1 in the second slot. Okay? If it acted on weight 3, I could define a delta 2, 1, which has weight 2 in the first slot, weight 1 in the second slot. It was important that here, well, there are many things that conspire. I said that there are no relations among different weights. This is important here. That's why I can separate them. If there were relations among different weights, this separation into 2, 1, 1 wouldn't make sense because they could talk to each other. So here, it is weight 2, which means that C is actually just a multiple of zeta 2. But that means that I can get it, it's a constant, by just putting z to any value I like, in particular z equal to 0. But z equal to 0, the first line tells me now it's zeta 2. And this gives me minus li 2 of 0, which is 0, plus c, so c is zeta 2. So I can recover this identity I gave you this morning just from the Hopf algebra. And the few minutes that are left, let's give one more example, which is slightly less trivial. Because this is a bit, yeah. This is a bit too simple. So example 2. So I now restrict myself to x between 0 and 1. And I fix the branch of the log such that this is this. Okay, this fixes the branch of the logarithm. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to derive for you the identity. What is this? The analytic continuation of the dialogue. And here you will see why pi must be special, because here you cross the branch cut, and you need the special rule for pi. Okay, well, let's act with delta on the original object. I start from here. Again, I strip off the 2 trivial bits. So I just look at delta 1, 1 of v2, 1 of x. And that is minus log 1 minus 1 over x, tensor log x. Good. Now what I can do is the following. I can go and write this as minus log 1 minus x minus log minus x, tensor log x. So what I essentially do is this log has a negative argument, and so I expose this log of a negative number. I can take it apart, so I get log 1 minus x tensor log x plus log of minus x tensor log x. Or log x. And let me now plug in this. So I get plus log x tensor log x minus I pi tensor log x. Okay? Now, the first term, you can easily convince yourself, is V2 of, and I must have made a sign mistake somewhere. No. Oh, yeah, sorry. Here it's 1 over x, because the dialog is evaluated 1 over x. And then when I change log 1 over x, log x, the signs change everywhere. An overall sign. And then I get here a minus sign, which is what I want. I have this guy. This, you can easily check, is 1/2, comes from 1/2 log square x. And then this, the last one, comes from I pi tensor log x. And here it is important that I had this special rule for pi, because you see it's asymmetric in pi. There is no pi on the other side that I would expect from the symmetric product. It's just not there. I just don't get it. So it's very important that pi behaves in a special way. And so last but not least, what I conclude is that V2 of 1 over x with this particular choice for the branches is minus V2 of x plus or minus 1/2 log square x plus I pi log x plus a constant such that delta 1/1 of c is equal to 0. Which means I expect c to be a multiple of zeta 2 because I'm at weight 2. And indeed, if I put x equal to 1, which is precisely the branch point, I get zeta 2 equals minus zeta 2 plus 0 plus 0 plus c. So c is 0. C is 2 zeta 2, sorry. Sorry? Well, I'm at the boundary, right? I'm approaching it from below. That is important point. OK? So now, of course, to be fair, I mean, if you do it in real for real-life applications, you don't just do it like this. You do it by computer, because expressions get very big. But the general philosophy is the same. Whenever you have an expression and you want to transform it in some way, you can act with the co-product to break it into smaller bits for which you recursively know already what to do. For example, I could now also derive V3 of 1 over x. Then the delta, I would compute something like delta 2, 1, which would have V2 of 1 over x in the first slot for which I know already what the answer is. And then I bootstrap my way up. It's actually just the same philosophy as for the amplitude bootstrap in the end. Okay? Okay? Yeah, I think time is up, so we stop here and then we continue tomorrow.
Any questions? Is it possible to use these multivariate functions at Manod remiss instead of discontinuities?
Yeah. Actually, then, so if you really consider monotomy, so you have like the group that acts on it, the statement would be that if you act with delta on the function where you change the contour, it's the same as just changing the integration contour in the first slot. That is actually the mathematical statement, the way it is phrased in mathematics. I just phrase it with discontinuities because that's probably more familiar to physicists.
Can I ask a silly question? I mean, if I knew nothing about this, and if you want to prove this equation, I'd probably differentiate it.
Mm-hmm.
And then, so are you telling me that if you go to bigger identities, that
this is much more efficient than systematically
differentiated. Yeah. In the end, due to the fact that the second slot is differentiation, remember that this the co-product knows about differentiation, the two are in the end equivalent. You could also do it by manipulating the integral representation. But it's all just different ways of doing the same thing. This has the advantage that it's purely combinatorial, algebraic and combinatorial. It's mostly a matter of efficiency. If you have to do it on, for example, if I give you such a g function, many variables, you say, I can do it by differentiation, but how do you get the derivative in the first place? For example, the way I would compute the derivative would be via the coproduct itself. So it's because it's all algebraic and combinatorial, you can just do it in a combinatorial way. That's the main advantage.
Anything? Okay, let's thank Claude again.
No, it's very nice.